scripture lesson is found on page 1209. 1209 in your pew handle. We're continuing, actually this week we're finishing up our look at John's first letter. And this week we're picking up on chapter 4. We're going to go from verse 7 through verse 21. All right? John writes, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear. Because fear has to do with punishment, the one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, 'I love God,' yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God who he has not seen. And he has given us this command: whoever loves God must also love his brother." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thank you. 27 times, John uses the word agape, love. One of the words for love in the Greek language. Agape love is shoulder-to-shoulder love. It's the love that exists between brothers and sisters, and especially brothers and sisters, it's the kind of love that helps us as members to shoulder each other's burdens and to celebrate in each other's joys. I want to tell you, because of my agape love for Dan Aldridge, I'm not going to let him carry the cross of eating every one of those desserts by himself. I'm with you, brother. I'm with you. 27 times the word love is used here, and it's even also two other times used is in that expression, dear friends, or beloved, it sometimes gets translated. That word love is so huge, it has to be, and it needs to be, a huge priority for us. God's love is amazing. Combined with God's grace, it can conquer just about anything. And God is so gracious. I think there's one story in the Bible in particular that really points this out. It's probably one of the funniest books in the Bible, and that's the book of Jonah. Now, I struggled and finally gave up trying to find Jonah. He's hiding again. Jonah is, it's the Old Testament. And I'm not going to find it again. Oh, I found him. Okay. Hey, Jonah. All right. Page 917 is the third chapter of Jonah. If you're familiar with the story of Jonah, God has given Jonah a mission. He's to go and to really prophesy against the Ninevites. In 40 days, they're going to get destroyed. No ifs, ands, and buts. No getting around it. This is what it is. And Jonah hates the Ninevites so much, and they hate the Israelites so much. I mean, there's a lot of battle going on between these two, and the Ninevites are particularly fierce. And Jonah is just like, I'm not going to do this. And instead of going to Nineveh, he gets on a boat headed towards Tarshish, the opposite direction. And we know what happens in that story. A big storm comes up, they cast lots, they find out who the culprit is, and they throw him overboard. And what happens to him? He gets swallowed by a fish. Now, he could have gone to Nineveh by road. He could have gone there in a really nice, kind of comfortable way of getting there. But instead, he gets hauled off to Nineveh. Where? In the belly of a great fish. I'm sure that was a lovely place to spend 3 days. He prays, and he's all sorts of humble and grateful for his life. And, you know, he carries on about like that. But then he gets spat out. He gets spat out. He got thrown up on the Greek shore. It's hysterical. The story is really funny. And so he goes in and he preaches this. He says to them, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. That's it. It's about 5 words in Hebrew. That's it. That's all he says to them. And the whole kingdom repents. The whole kingdom puts on sackcloth and ashes. Even the animals are wearing this. And they repent of their sin. And God does what God does. He forgives them. And boy, does that really tick off Jonah. Because he wanted them to get it. They deserved it. He says, I knew that you were going to do this. He says, Lord, this is not what I said when I was still at home. This is why I was so quick to flee from Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger, abounding in love of God, and relents from sending calamity. No, Lord, take away my life, for it's better for me to die than to live. This is terrible. God says, you've been concerned about all these things. Cannot be more concerned about Nineveh. More than 120,000 people can't tell the right from their left. Should I not be concerned about that great city? This is the love that God has. God can change the future. This priority of love is so vital to us. Again, John keeps repeating it over and over again about the importance of love. This is love. This is not love. He points out the priority of this, but he emphasizes it twice, once in verse 8 and one in verse 15, when he says, God is love. Now, that's a little thorny, and I want to point something out here. John is not saying that love is God. He's saying that God is love. It's a little different. There's a wonderful book by A.W. Tozer called The Knowledge of the Holy. And in that book, he talks about all the different attributes about God. He talks about God's omnipotence, his being almighty, all-powerful. His omniscience, all-knowing, all-seeing. You know, past, present, and future, that's for our benefit. God sees all of that all at once. He's omniscient. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere. Even the places where we don't think he is. He's everywhere. And he's loving. He is love. You know, of those qualities, we can't do any of that stuff, right? We can't do that. We will always be right where we are, wherever that happens to be. I think it was Buckaroo Banzai that says, remember, no matter where you go, there you are. No, we'll never be omnipresent. We can study the past and interpret the present, And if we have really good data, we can make some predictions about trends in the future, but we'll never be all-knowing. Omniscient, all-seeing. We may become people of influence within our communities. We may be people of influence because of our money. We may become people of influence because of whatever kind of authority and power we have managed to root up for ourselves, but we will never be all-powerful. We'll never be all-powerful. The one trait of God, the one attribute of God that we can emulate is a capacity to love. We can do that. We can love. Doesn't matter how much money you have. You can still love. It doesn't matter how much schooling you have. You can still love. It doesn't matter how powerful you become. The Dalai Lama says, if you think you're too small to make a difference, try sleeping in a room with a mosquito. We can still have some influence. But the way we do it is through our love. Last night, let me back up a minute. I'm training in my running. I think I've shared with you that I'm a runner. And my training plan called for me to run 5 miles yesterday. And we got busy. We wound up we didn't have to, but we did. We went up to Dalton and had a surprise birthday party for my son. And by the time we got back, it was 11 o'clock. Guess what? Hadn't put in my 5 miles. So I put on my shorts and my sneakers and my headlamp and ran around over here. Turns out it's almost a perfect quarter mile in this little inner loop right around here that goes around here. So yeah, I ran around it 20 times. Okay. While I was running, I saw a couple people start to walk up. Now this is about 11, it'd be about 11:30 or so. I saw a couple people walk up. And I was a little leery, you know. Billy was following me in the car, so I wasn't too scared. but you know, they were walking up, and then I saw that it was two boys, two young men. One of them, I'm guessing, probably high school, maybe sophomore. The other one was, I'm guessing, middle school, not much older than that. Now, here's the thing. I could have just put my head down and kept on running like some crazy guy running around in circles in the middle of the night. I could have done that. Or I could have said, what are you doing out here in the middle of the night? But I was running around in circles for about an hour with a lamp on my head, so I really wasn't coming from any kind of position of authority at that moment. So I said, hi. They said, hello. I said, how y'all doing? Okay. Kept on running. A little bit later, they came back. Now this time when they came back, they said, they are asking me about the run-in. They were wondering, how much more did I have to go? I said, well, I still got a mile to go. And, you know, we just talked a little bit. The next time I see them, and considering that this is Winterville, I probably will see them again. We've already established some contact. I bet they're talking about different. You would not believe what we saw running around the square last night. It was this old guy with a lamp on his head. Why were they out there? I don't know. I'm guessing that they were probably doing what young men, boys do on a nice summer night. Probably just going down to the gas station to get a soda, enjoy their freedom, you know? Might have been something different. Might have been like some kids I knew back in Salt Lake City who, it wasn't unusual to see them out on the street at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. Either because mama had been drinking and had a boyfriend over. And so they got kicked out. Or mama had been drinking and didn't have a boyfriend over. In which case, it was better for them to leave. I don't know. I'd like to think it's the other. They seem to be in pretty good spirits. What if I had just kept running? What if I didn't say hello? I wonder about that. It's easy, especially these days, to get fearful. There's so much fear in our world today. So much fear. And what fear does is it makes us anxious. We're afraid of losing something, or our health, or our person, or our money, or whatever. And what that happens after that is the fear goes to anxiety, and the anxiety causes us to withdraw and turn in, and turn inward. We get caught up in ourselves and our safety. We get concerned about our family, their safety. And really, maybe it's just a couple guys going out for a soda. Fear. But John tells us this in this letter, that perfect love casts out fear. Perfect love. A couple places he talks about perfect love, or he talks about love being completed. It's actually the same thing. Love being brought to its logical, love being brought to its conclusion, its perfection. John, here in the letter, instructs us that's something that we need to be working towards. We need to be working towards being more loving. And John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, I'm sure you've heard of him, says that our goal is to be made perfect in love. When I went up to be ordained, that was one of the questions he asked. Are you moving onward to perfection? Do you expect to be made perfect in love in this lifetime? And the correct answer is, yes, Bishop. But I really believe that. That is our goal, is to be made perfect in love. Why? Because if God can care about people like the Ninevites and all that they did against his chosen people, he must really love the world. In fact, John says that God so loved the world, the whole world, everything in it, especially that part that was turned against him, that he sent his only son, Jesus Christ. That's what John 3:16 said. We're to be made perfect in love. It is what we're striving for. And the thing I find out more often, and boy, I tell you, it really bothers me, but it's true. The thing I find out more often about love and my ability to love is that if I'm not actively, consciously working towards that, I'm neglecting it. If I'm not actively working on becoming a more loving person, then I'm neglecting it. And John says in this letter, 30 times, you're beloved, you need to love, this is what love looks like, this is what love doesn't look like. And not only that, he says, we're able to love because God first loved us. God empowers us by his Holy Spirit to love each other and together to love the world as God loves it, not with the worldly love, but with the love of a God who wants to see all of it reconciled to himself. And we need to be working at it. One of the things to try. I've heard this. I haven't done it yet. I'm not sure if I'm courageous enough just yet. But I've heard it. I will try it. And I encourage you to do it. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is called the love chapter of 1 Corinthians. Love is patient. Love is kind. You know, so on and so forth. Instead of saying love is, put your own name in. John is patient. John keeps no record of wrongs. Don't use my computer on it. But if we do that and we examine ourselves, at the end of the day, this is a spiritual practice. It's been around for centuries. We ask ourselves at the end of the day, have we been more loving? Have we reflected God's love in the places that we've been? That doesn't mean we have to start from a chapter and verse of people. Are we just being godly people? Are we godly with each other? Are we loving with each other? Boy, that's so vital. Billy and I went on our first cruise a little over 2 years ago. She reminded me this morning at the 8:45 service, see, they got the rough draft of this. Y'all get the good stuff. She reminded me that we went to the Bahamas, not Bermuda, which I thought, but Bahamas. And we stopped off at Nassau and had a great time. It was a wonderful journey. If you've never been on a cruise, you really got to go. You get ice cream for breakfast if you want.